Hello, everyone. I hope you're enjoying the 2020 TCM Classic Film Festival Special Home Edition. I'm Alicia Malone, and I'm joined in Zoom by Professor Jacqueline Stewart. Hi, how are you?
Hey, Alicia, I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm doing good. I mean, there's been a lot of jigsaw puzzles happening over here, a lot of movie watching, and I'm thankful for any time I get to see your lovely face and talk about movies.
Same. I wish we were together, but this is the next best thing. So, and Zoom is a regular part of my life now. We're teaching our courses online on Zoom at University of Chicago and every university. So, slowly getting used to this mode of chatting with people. Yeah.
It's a whole new world. Well, The good thing is this afternoon we get to talk about Baby Face, which is playing as part of the TCM Classic Film Festival. It's on at 12:15 a.m. on Sunday. And this is a wonderful pre-code film from 1933, directed by Alfred Green. And so let's talk a little bit about how this film first came about, because the idea really started with Daryl Zanuck, didn't it?
Yes, he wrote the screenplay and didn't put his name on it. It was the Depression era, and he felt that he should, not get. He was already getting paid. He had a salary at a time many people were out of work. So he took $1 for this. And one of the really interesting things about developing this story is that he and the star of the film, Barbara Stanwyck, really worked closely together in developing the story.
Yeah, that's right. She was involved in the story meetings right from the beginning. And it was her who suggested that her character, Lily Powers, great name, that her father should be the one who really forces her at the beginning to entertain the men at his establishment. And she was such a wonderful actress, particularly when it came to these working class characters. You know, I know she was a bit worried about this role because it had less sympathy than many of her other roles before this, but she had great power in Hollywood, didn't she? Wonderful actress.
Yeah, just amazing. I mean, she really carries this film. And the film critic Michael Phillips describes her as an icy hot actress. And it's totally true. She brings both of those qualities to this role. And as you were saying, to so many of these other roles where she plays working class women. And in this one, I mean, we have to imagine just how gratifying it was for audiences in the early 1930s to see this kind of like rags to riches story. And boy, does the film play up how depraved the kind of working class environment is for her, and then how opulent the riches part of the narrative becomes for her.
Absolutely. And she goes from rags to riches by using her sexuality as currency. That's really the only power she has, is her power over men. And it's so interesting that towards the beginning of the film, she gets advice from a friend. I think he's a cobbler, and he is reading Nietzsche, you know, the great like nihilist philosopher, and tells her that she should start taking matters into her own hands, and she should be a master and not a slave, and use men to get the things that she wants. So I know there's been a lot of debate about this film over the years from feminist film critics. What do you think about it? Do you think it's empowering to see a woman take charge of her sexuality, or exploitative?
Well, I think it there's a little bit of both, Alicia. You know, I mean, this is certainly a film that's made within the context of a very patriarchal Hollywood structure and social structure. So how do you read scenes like one that was restored to this film, actually? And we'll talk about the way that it was censored. But when a man is leering at her and kind of, you know, the camera moves up from her legs, then kind of slowly up to see her face. It is displaying her body, no question. At the same time, though, it's telling us something about how men are looking at her. So as a film that demonstrates just how superficial men can be and the ways that sexism work, that is a valuable thing. That is something that certainly feeds a kind of, you know, feminist analysis. So I think that it's one of the reasons why the film is so interesting is because it plays both sides of this question.
Yeah, I think that's such a great point. And that's why I love watching pre-code films, is because you get to see these women have some sort of sexual autonomy, take control of their sexuality. I know that Daryl Zanuck was inspired to make this film after the success of Redheaded Woman, which is also playing as part of the TCM Classic Film Festival at Home Edition.
One of your favorites, right? That's one
yes.
of your favorites.
Yes. I love watching
Jean Harlow. I
wonder why. Yeah, as well as the title, obviously. I love watching Jean Harlow in that role and just how animalistic she is and ferocious, and we see that here with Barbara Stanwyck. It's also great to see Teresa Harris as Chico, and this is another interesting role that I would love to get your thoughts on, because on one hand, you know, she has a big role, I imagine, for women of color at the time. That must have been unusual, but she's also playing a subservient role.
Yes, Teresa Harris is one of my favorite actors in Hollywood history, and one of the most exciting moments for me, I have to say, watching Babyface is just seeing Teresa Harris's name in the opening credits, right? Because that didn't always happen for actresses who were playing these servant roles, or for Black actors more generally during this period. And she's a significant character in this film. We hear her singing St. Louis Blues across the course of the movie. There are other films that show a really, you know, kind of close, intimate relationship between white stars and their maids. I'm thinking about something like Blonde Venus, for example, where Hattie McDaniel has a moment where she really is seen to be like in solidarity with Marlena Dietrich's character. Mm-hmm. But I think that there's something more happening in Babyface. There's a sisterhood that's implied there. They're both, as you see early on, that she moves with her over the course of her rags to riches story. But the way that she can kind of remain a part of her friend's life is through playing, you know, being a maid. So again, there's an ambivalence there that tells us a lot about what the social possibilities were for the relationships between white women and Black women during that period. But for it to come up in a Hollywood film in this way is really significant, just because so many other of these servant roles were minimized, where they didn't even have lines. You know, they're almost just props or purely stereotypical. And here we get a much more, I would say, sophisticated and important character.
Yeah, she has a name. So
she has a
good
name. Exactly. And she's such a fascinating actress. Lynn Nottage wrote a play called Meet Vera Stark that is largely based on Teresa Harris. And the ways that these characters are so essential, these actors have been so essential to Hollywood filmmaking, and how deeply appreciative we are when we just get these flashes of more depth, you know, more complexity.
Absolutely. And this film being a pre-code movie, it wasn't beholden to the very strict code that came later, which I think affected a lot of women and women of color especially. But they did have to be mindful of the censorship office. And I know that William Hayes was making his emergency trip to Hollywood to try to, you know, stamp out these kind of outrageous films. And this movie was finished just before he arrived. And when he saw it, he was speechless. And then later on, Joseph Breen, he actually rewrote some of those speeches, right?
Yes, that's right. Yes. And some clunky ways. Fortunately, we get to see the version of the film that before it was cut, or the scenes are restored to this film that, you know, that were seen as problematic, many of them, as you're saying, you know, related to this really open and brazen representation of a woman in charge of her own sexuality. The Nietzsche passages also presented, you know, a problem to censors in New York and elsewhere. But I think that there was a way in which, recognizing that Zanuck and Stanwyck, that the filmmakers were so bold in the kinds of claims that they were trying to make about women's sexuality and about the way that sexism and patriarchy work, I think it really complicates the ways that we think. These pre-code films complicate how we think about classic Hollywood films. There's a real, there's a major shift that happens, right, in the early 1930s, where things get clamped down and explained away in really kind of like in the name of creating some kind of like closure or, you know, moral statement that supposedly audiences needed so that they wouldn't be negatively influenced by these films. But these pre-code films show us that there was a much more sophisticated way that screenwriters and directors and audiences were able to think about these controversial topics.
Absolutely. My cat is playing with her toy down there. If you hear some noises clanging about, she's
Where is she?
Playing all around all the lights, which is very safe. But I agree with you. I mean, when I watch a pre-code movie, it's always surprising to me because I think I learned so much history from watching classic films that in a way I start to believe that that's how everyone behaved in the 1940s and 50s. And then you see some of these really racy films in the 30s, it completely changes your perspective on that. Plus, you know, once the code started to be strictly enforced, we didn't get to see women have this frank sexuality, or if they did, they would have to be punished by the end of it, often by dying at the end of the film. And women of color, of course, they couldn't be in interracial relationships. And so unless you had two black leads, you couldn't have, you know, a white lead and a black lead together. So it really did change a lot of things. And something that I always find interesting to think about is if filmmaking was better for the code or worse. You know, in some ways, it's probably a mixture of both, right? Because in some ways, I think the writing got very better. That's my cat.
Trying to be a part of the show. You want to join the conversation?
Yes. I'll grab her if she comes close. She's running around. Crazy times. But yeah, so with the code, you know, the code, I think it forced writers to become a little more tricky, a little more nuanced in talking about sex. So I think there's an argument to be had both ways.
Right. We get the trains going through the tunnels. And
yes.
Fireworks, you know, or but I have to say, as folks will see when they watch this film, I mean, we don't see her full out, you know, in bed. She's in bed maybe once in the film. Instead, there are these really interesting, provocative ways that her sexual activities are conveyed in the film. But still, there's it doesn't leave to question.
The camera just sort of cuts away, and you're like, "Oh, I know what happened. Here, let me see if I can."
No,
that's my cat, Miss Hayworth, but she's being camera shy, unlike her namesake. Uh-huh. Well, I'm so excited that everyone gets to watch Babyface at home. It's playing Sunday, 12:15 a.m. So stay up late. That's Eastern Standard Time. And join us for the 2020 TCM Classic Film Festival Stay at Home Audition. Jacqueline, thank you so much for joining me. It's always lovely to talk to you.
Of course, Alicia. Really wonderful to see you. Maybe Miss Hayworth next time.
Yes. Stay healthy.
You too. Take care.
Bye.